Next on Enviro Close Up, Beyond Pesticides with Jay Feldman. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman with Jay Feldman, Executive Director of the organization Beyond Pesticides. Welcome, Jay.
Thank you, and it's great to be with you, Carl. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you.
First off, what is, Jay, Beyond Pesticides?
Well, we're an advocacy organization. We were founded in 1981. Our goal really is to eliminate the use of petrochemical pesticides and fertilizers. Originally, we grew out of a series of field hearings in the southern tier of the U.S., Florida, Texas, California, where we documented farm worker poisonings associated with pesticides. Our goal at that time was to collect enough data to develop a farm worker protection standard. And this was back in the late 1970s. Believe it or not, farm workers are really the only occupational group that's not covered by the Occupational Safety and Health Administration. Farm workers are, or I should say that their exposures to toxic chemicals in the workplace are covered by the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. And when we started working on developing the background material necessary for a worker protection standard, there was a half a page in the Code of Federal Regulations to protect farm workers. And it said, farm workers shall not re-enter the fields until the sprays have settled or the dusts have settled and the sprays have dried. And that was it. There were a couple of what they call re-entry standards, where they establish a period of time in which workers must stay out of the field after the chemical is sprayed. But that really, you know, that was my awakening. I grew up in a suburban area outside New York City, and understanding what was going on in agriculture was really new to me. And I had the opportunity to sit down with farm workers in labor camps, talk to them about their experiences, the miscarriages, the rashes, the respiratory diseases, and saw the exposure not only in their workplace, where many of these workers were in the fields when the sprays, crop dusters were coming down. They had human flaggers that indicated to the crop duster where they should turn around. I mean, you know, talk about exploitation in the context of chemical exposure. This really did and continues to epitomize the challenges we face in terms of adequate regulation of toxic chemicals. Now, we move from that, it continues to be a major focus of ours, but we moved into this sort of food area and agricultural area. You know, you can't sort of be in an agricultural area and see this contamination, not only of people, but the environment and waterways, drifting of chemicals over people's homes, without really recognizing that there's got to be an alternative to this. You know, there's got to be another way to grow food. And along the way, I did meet organic farmers who, you know, were basically appalled by growing food with toxic chemicals. And, you know, we're able to find, you know, livelihood and productivity in production systems that were not reliant on toxic chemicals. So the organization sort of marries these two concepts. One, what do we know about these toxic chemicals that are widely used in our environment that result in not only exposure to farm workers, but consumers who eat the food, to ecosystems in which the food is grown, affecting wildlife, and then quickly learned about suburban use. You know, you've heard of chemical companies like True Green, chemical lawn care companies that basically sell services that are dependent on chemical applications, and began to collect the data that really justifies the concern. And so we maintain, and we started back then, databases, scientific databases that track the adverse effects of pesticides on health and the environment. We have something called the Pesticide-Induced Diseases Database, and it's shocking, really, the kinds of diseases that are either initiated or promoted by chemical and pesticide exposure, from basic neurological diseases, immunological, reproductive, to respiratory impacts that result in elevated disease rates of diabetes, Alzheimer's, brain disease, behavioral disorders, autism. And so these are what I'm referring to are peer-reviewed, independent peer-reviewed scientific studies that evaluate these sorts of adverse effects. More recently, we're seeing public concern about bees. And that really is the entry point into this question of what are the ecosystem effects? We know from following the data on impacts on ecosystems that we're really living through what has been dubbed an insect apocalypse. We've seen over the last several decades a 70%, 70 or 80% reduction in insect populations. And that has food chain effects, right? If we're killing off insects, what are the birds going to eat, right? So we're in a situation where we've created a great degree of dependency on these toxic chemicals in our lives, and we study what those impacts are, but we really use that information at the local, state, and national, and even international level to advance alternative practices that are no longer dependent on these chemicals.
Now, you say on your website, in you state the mission of Beyond Pesticides, and let me note it's Beyond Pesticides based in the nation's capital, Washington, D.C. And you say Beyond Pesticides believes that people must have a voice in decisions that affect them directly. We believe decisions should not be made for us by chemical companies or by decision makers who either do not have all the facts or refuse to consider them. Quite an articulate summary of what you're trying to do.
Well, it starts with information, right? It starts with people understanding what the chemicals are, what their potential adverse effects are, and whether really they're necessary. Because I think we've been brought up, I know I was brought up to believe that these chemicals are necessary for productivity, for profitability, for, issues around public health. We talk about disease vectors, insect-borne disease vectors, West Nile virus, et cetera, that we can't survive without these toxic chemicals. So that's sort of ingrained in us. And if you were to listen only to the regulators, whether it's at the state level or at the federal level, in this case, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, you would think, well, there's nothing wrong, that it's fine that we're exposed to tens of thousands of pesticides and ingredients and mixtures and chemicals that have aggregate effects and synergistic effects. So information's power. I mean, that's the basis of our belief system that we can empower advocacy with science, and that sort of understanding around what the interactions are, what is known, what is not known, what are the uncertainties, and what do you do with that information? And that information then can be utilized by not only activists or advocates who work at the local level, work with their city councils, county councils, boards of supervisors to influence the policies on land management in those communities, work with their state elected officials and influence the policies there and all the way up to the federal level. So, you know, it does start with having a voice and having an informed voice and being empowered and, you know, not being cowed by the presumption that something is safe because it's on the market or something is safe because a regulatory agency basically made a determination that it should be allowed on the market without understanding the deficiencies and limitations of that regulatory process. So we're focused on the science and then we're focused on the policy. We call our, you know, we basically say that we engage in science, policy, and action. And in each category, we need to be informed to do these, to take these steps that are protective of our families, of our communities, of our environment.
Now, speaking of information, Rachel Carson and her work, particularly Silent Spring, very important to your organization, published in 1962. I use it in my environmental journalism class at the State University of New York at Old Westbury. And, I mean, that information, Rachel Carson's scientifically sound information, impeccable research she did, led to the end of the use of, well, DDT in the United States. But there is so much else to be done these days. I mean, I think of Roundup, you know, and the it's a ubiquitous doing all kinds of damage.
The most widely used herbicide, yes, weed killer. Yeah, you know, you make a very important point. Rachel Carson was certainly a turning point and did inform decision makers and had tremendous impact. And we think about that book as really influencing the ultimate decision to ban DDT. And that's an interesting sort of outcome of the book. I don't think she intended that to be the only outcome. In fact, she talks in Silent Spring about the need to consider the fact that we live in complex biological communities or with complex biological communities. And that we shouldn't be hurling toxic chemicals at these biological communities, and that we should make wider use of alternatives. And at that time, she was writing about DDT, as you say, which is in the organochlorine family of pesticides. So it's chlordane, aldrin, dieldrin, DDT, chlorinated hydrocarbons, very persistent, have long residual lives, and stick around. We're still finding the breakdown product of DDT, DDE in our food supply. So these are chemicals that have a legacy. We're hearing about legacy chemicals now around the whole conversation of PFAS, which is a chemical that has been widely used as coatings and is often found in pesticides as either an inert ingredient or as a contaminant. But the point is that I think a lot of effort has been put into banning individual chemicals. We were awakened to the reality that there were chemicals on the market that shouldn't be. And we started as an environmental community, which really came together in the 70s, right, to go after individual chemicals, really. You mentioned Roundup. Glyphosate is the active ingredient. There are numerous chemicals, you know, along the way. We spent, oh my gosh, resources on getting rid of chlordane, which was widely used as a termite insecticide all over the country. And you can spend a career banning individual chemicals. Well, so at that point, we stepped back after spending all these resources on chlordane. We stepped back and said, we'll never get to all these chemicals that are on the market. And you know what? As we ban one, another one pops up. And then we go chasing after that one. So we went from organochlorines to organophosphates. And many of the listeners have heard about chlorpyrifos, which was an insect or is an insecticide that have been banned on residential uses because of neurotoxic impacts on children, but EPA left the agricultural uses on the market and knew for decades that farm worker children and children in rural areas were having adverse impacts on their brain development. Finally, the chemical was banned essentially under a court order, which ordered EPA to go back, having failed, the court found, to fully evaluate the impacts of the chemical based on the science. And that was finally done and just recently was reversed on appeal. So we have this chemical, highly neurotoxic chemical that causes brain impacts, adverse effects on the brain, widely used in agriculture and showing up in our food as residues. Again, yet another example of a chemical that should not be on the market. So, you know, when this story is painted of chemical after chemical, chemical family after chemical family. In fact, the most recent or chemical family that is on the chopping block, or at least controversial, are the neonicotinoids. These are the chemicals associated with the decline of bee populations, honeybees, native bees, and other pollinators, because this chemical is systemic in that it is absorbed by the plant and then is expressed through the pollen, nectar, and gutation droplets. So what does that mean? That means that as insects are foraging in field, in our gardens, among our flowers, in agricultural fields, they are poisoned as a result of feeding or foraging on those plants. So we've jumped from chemical family to chemical family, and we are at the point now where enough is enough. You know, we last this week, I think it was, we did an article on our daily news, which is our daily review of science and policy, of a chemical called aldecarb, which is again a highly neurotoxic chemical, which Bayer had agreed to ban back in 91. And now the chemical is being brought back because growers want to use it. They're demanding that it be used. So EPA is now considering allowing this chemical to be used. Now, my friends at EPA will correct me because I'm trying to paint broad generalities and there are a lot of specifics here. When you hear of chemicals being banned, these chemicals are mostly voluntarily withdrawn. EPA engages in long negotiations with chemical manufacturers. And what happens in a negotiated process? Compromise. You compromise with those you're negotiating with because you want an outcome that's better than you think you could get or less costly than going through some sort of litigation. And what happens in that process, as did happen with aldecarb in the early 90s, is that the agency orchestrated a voluntary cancellation. And unbeknownst to the public, even though Bayer announced we will no longer be producing or selling aldecarb, other formulators picked up that chemical and it began to be marketed in 24 states in agricultural crops. So this is a complex set of negotiations and power relationships in which the chemical industry is extremely powerful in influencing what the law says and then how the regulations are written. And so we have a law that has this esoteric name called the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide, and Rodenticide Act. That's our Clean Air Act in the pesticide realm. And that empowers EPA to do these negotiations, to compromise our health, to engage in risk assessment calculations that do not take into account the range of vulnerabilities in the population, pre-existing conditions, the impacts on children. Certain endpoints are not considered, like impacts on the endocrine system, which is the message system in our body that controls all the functions of our organs. And so we have at the end of the day a pesticide on the market with instructions or a product label that instructs on how to mix it, how to apply it, and all these standards that are required for compliance with the law, which is the label on this product. But when you look behind the label and you look at, well, what does EPA know? Has it looked at mixtures? Has it looked at endocrine disruption? Has it looked at the synergistic effects between pharmaceuticals, drugs, and pesticides, which we know occur synergistic effects, which elevates the potency of any one of the individual chemicals in that mixture? Do we know all the impacts of the ingredients there in a formulation, in a bottle you go and buy at your local hardware store? That's what's called a formulation. And in that formulation is, let's take Roundup, is glyphosate the active ingredient in Roundup, but that's typically a small percentage of all the stuff in that bottle, whether it's a liquid, or a dust, a powder, or a granule. And so when you look at next time you're at a hardware store and just walk over to the pesticide section, pick up a pesticide product, look at the back of it at the ingredient statement, and you'll see the word inert ingredient on that label. And in most cases, the inert ingredient will be over 50% of the product formulation. And those inert ingredients can be highly toxic. I mean, it could be xylene, benzene, there could be all kinds of chemicals. There could be contaminants in there like dioxins. And so that is not disclosed to the consumer at the point of sale. It's not, even if you try to research it, that information is not disclosed on the product label. So we don't have good information. We have a poor regulatory system. And it turns out we have other methods, non-toxic, non-chemical methods, to achieve the pest management goals that these chemicals are marketed for. And that's where we're putting a lot of our energy. I'd like to say one other thing that's really critical to this whole issue. As we experience and see in real time the existential crises that we're facing as a world community, I mean, we're seeing climate change on the nightly news. We see biodiversity collapse with the disappearance that people notice, the disappearance of insects and birds. We see elevated rates of disease, cancer, and other diseases in our families, in ourselves. And so clearly we need to do something different, right, than what we're doing now when it comes to the regulation of toxic chemicals, especially when we see that there is this association with these adverse effects and chemical exposure. To be holistic means to step back and look at what impact we're having on the whole environment. And is there another way that we can grow our food, manage our lawns, take care of our insect-borne diseases, manage pests in our home without these toxic chemicals? And the answer is yes. And the beauty of that answer, meaning these alternatives are available to us now. It's not like we need more research. It's not like we need to teach ourselves what to do. We have models and examples. And so Beyond Pesticides is taking that experience and going to communities around the country and transitioning our playing fields, our parks, our schoolyards to organic land management. And one of the key element here is that process that a community goes through in transitioning to organic is a process that intersects with the climate crisis, with biodiversity decline, and health effects. And so what we're doing is we're not only eliminating fossil fuel, petroleum-based pesticides and fertilizers, taking that exposure to greenhouse gases out of the system, but we're also drawing down carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and sequestering it in the soil. So There's a huge bright spot out there, which gives me hope. When we almost feel, when we see what's going on in terms of environmental degradation and the flooding and the fires and the erratic temperatures that we're experiencing, we almost feel like the solution is out of reach. But in effect, we do have a holistic solution if we just choose to use it.
Speaking of action, and you focus on action beyond pesticides, how can the viewers join in your so important campaigns? What can they do?
These days, people connect over the internet, certainly. And we have a website, Beyond Pesticides, beyondpesticides.org. And that is a great way to connect with these issues. And, as I like to say, they're different entry points. You may be concerned about your children. You may be concerned about your pets. You may be concerned about the food you eat. You may be concerned about how your food is grown and impacts it has on the workers, farm workers, and the communities in which toxic chemicals are used. There are so many opportunities to engage with this issue and with us to become an advocate, a change agent in your community. A big focus of our program right now is a campaign we have called Parks for Sustainable Future, because this is a point at which communities can talk to their parks districts, their parks department. They can talk to their public works department. They can say, hey, what are we doing to manage the park that I use every day and walk with my children or grandchildren and pets? What chemicals are you using? Are you using any chemicals? I heard of this organization, Beyond Pesticides, that is able to work with us to help convert our parks to organic land management. And that's one program, one example of how you can get involved tomorrow. Someone, listening to this show could pick up the phone tomorrow, call us, and literally we could be on the phone with your parks department the next week. That's how quickly this type of program can be turned around.
And your phone number?
202-543-5450.
And just let me say that in my, how many years, 60 years of focusing in on environmental, abuses through environmental journalism, I found that virtually all polluting products and processes have safe, green, healthy alternatives. And it's just a matter of, I think, of action by people at the grassroots to change the, Rachel Carson was right there, and we have to join with really what she began. She's considered the mother of the modern environmental movement. We have to join in that action to change things. Thank you so much, Jay. You are so articulate.
Pleasure to be here.
Truly, this has been Carl Grossman. Thank you for watching this Enviro Close-Up.